Well, ladies and gentlemen, for the sixth time, you're extremely welcome. I can hardly believe that we've reached the last evening, because it seems like yesterday since we had that first meeting in the first day or two of February. And as I've done each time, just to remind you very briefly of the journey. The pre-Reformation Church, just a view of the medieval church, a look at some of the causes of what was to come. It was a time of tremendous change all over Europe, just on the verge of it. And the Reformation, as we've seen, was actually part of a much bigger picture. Then we looked at the life of Martin Luther. And in fact, the whole reason, in a sense, why we're doing this in the first place was that in 2017 is the 500th anniversary of Luther's alleged nailing of his thesis to the door. Then we looked at John Calvin. Then the bishop spoke to us about the Reformation of Scotland. And the last time we met, I spoke to you about the Council of Trent. The purpose all along, in my mind, as I've explained each week, was to try and help the wider community, really, to look at the whole question of the Reformation, because we've all grown up with one way or another a kind of one-sided view of it. And so the first thing to do is to discover, as far as we can, the facts of it, to the extent that there are such things as facts. And I think we've tried to do that. But in a sense now, we've come to the most important thing of all, which is not about what happened 5 centuries ago, but it's about what's happening now. To hear something about the state of ecumenism in Scotland at this time, because it's absolutely vital, whether it's in West Kilbride or in other places, that we advance the cause of church unity, because the lack of it is one of the great scandals of history. And my hope is that, and I think it's true, that we have already made some advances within the village as a result of this course. And so the person who's going to speak to us now about ecumenism today is Father William Fadden. He's very much involved in this theme. Remember, originally we were hoping that the Reverend Alan Faulkner would be here and that they could do it together, because we do work together in that field. But Alan's gone off to Geneva, as you know, to supply for 3 months. Maybe to set up that city of God that Calvin thought. I don't know if I manage that. But anyway, Paul, would you like to speak to us? Thanks.
Thank you. And I do apologise, it was advertised as a dialogue with Alan, and it's going to turn into a monologue. So, but hopefully it will be dialogue, because you'll be able to kind of have this dialogue. Let's begin though with a prayer. This prayer comes from a study document I'm going to talk about later on, which was produced from the World Council of Churches meeting that some of us in Scotland were at a number of years ago. And this is the prayer that came from the particular conference. O God of life, lead us to justice and peace, that suffering people may discover hope, the scarred world find healing, and divided churches become visibly one, through the one who prayed for us, and in whom we are one body, your Son, Jesus Christ, who with you and the Holy Spirit is worthy to be praised, one God, now and forever. Amen. We'll come back to that later on. But thank you for the opportunity to come and share with you a wee bit about the situation today. Joseph Allen and I work together, and we're just going to talk about what was happening. So with him swanning off, I've had to actually prepare a presentation. So that was good, because it gave me the opportunity to put down in writing some of the really important things which are happening in the church in the ecumenical situation today. So basically, what I would like to do this evening is really just have an overview of where we are with ecumenism. First of all, the international situation. What's happening globally within the churches and the strive for unity? What's happening locally in Scotland? And how we're progressing and moving forward? And what are the different ways in which the churches are making a commitment to one another? And a wee bit, where do we go from here? And Joe said, it's not really the past that matters, it's the future. And so, if we can have this foundation of understanding, we can maybe move forward a wee bit more. and then just lead it to a conclusion. So that's the plan. We'll see if we can get there. In order to situate the whole understanding of where we're coming from, we've looked at the history of the Reformation. Well, the history of modern ecumenism really dates back to 1910, and it was Edinburgh which was instrumental in really giving a kickstart to the modern ecumenical movement. And what it was the World Missionary Congress, and different churches were represented. There was a whole experience that mission was crucial to the church, and a recognition if we were to do mission, then we had to be united in doing that mission. So the World Missionary Congress really gave the impetus for churches to look at themselves and say, what should we be doing in order to be more missionary? And if we want to be missionary, we have to start looking to working together. And so it was the beginning of that kind of ecumenical mindset and a commitment to unity. And it really was recognising a common concern for justice and for peace, that if mission depended on commitment to justice and to peace, then that could be the foundation for churches working together and progressing. So from that missionary understanding of church, the ecumenical movement really was born. That was 1910. In 2010, there was the 100th anniversary of it in Edinburgh, and it was celebrated in quite a substantial way, but it kind of petered out, and it was a really unfortunate, you know, waste of an opportunity perhaps. But we've got other opportunities with Luther's anniversary, with lots of different things going. But that's just to kind of tell us where we came from. And out of the 1910 Congress, the whole concept of mission, of peace, and faith and order, then the emergence became the World Council of Churches. And this was a real kind of bringing together of the Protestant churches.
And that suggests we shove it forward a little bit, but we're missing just the end.
Why? I'm sorry, right?
Is that okay?
Yep, because there's only pictures at that side, so you can miss out the pictures. A lot of people miss it. In fact, probably the images are more important than the results. So, World Council of Churches, a real important step in the ecumenical journey. And that was in Amsterdam in 1948, when lots of the Protestant and Reformed churches came together in order to have this body, in order to work together. Now, at present, there are now over 350 member churches which have come as part of this World Council of Churches, and they come to pray, to reflect, and to work for visible unity. And the different ways in which that comes about is quite striking. And it's the concept of what do we do in order to work for a visible unity within the churches. And it's important to remember the World Council of Churches is not a super church. It's not over and above every other church. But rather it's the churches coming together in order to work for unity. And it's not negotiating unity between churches, but it's all united together within that in a shared common prayer and shared common witness. Now, the Roman Catholic Church is not a member of the World Council of Churches, of those 350 ones there. Reason being, because each of those churches have a particular standing within the World Council of Churches, and they each have a particular vote, and it all goes by numbers which are there. But if the Catholic Church was in, it would just swamp everything. It would swamp the voting, it would swamp the discussions, it would do like that, because it would have to be, like, the Church of England is in it, so it would be the Catholic Church in England. The Catholic Church was out, and it would just be. So it works with the World Council of Churches. Catholic Church is represented in the Faith and Order group of the World Council of Churches, but it's not a full member, and that's how it works better that way. And that's how it's working with it. But the World Council of Churches was instrumental in helping the churches of the Reformation in a particular way to come together, and the Orthodox churches are united with that as well, some of the different Orthodox churches, which is quite significant. I just want to rush through the international situation in order to kind of move us forward into the local one. So, what the World Council of Churches does is it brings together the churches in order to dialogue and to make this commitment for unity. And they have assemblies every 7 or 8 years. And the Assembly of the World Council of Churches is the highest decision-making body of the World Council of Churches. And the last one was held in Busan in South Korea in 2013. There are over 3,000 participants from over 350 churches, and I was one of them. I was sent by the Action of Churches Together in Scotland to be the representative of the churches of Scotland to be at that particular conference. That's incredible, because the Catholic Church had its own representation, the Vatican was represented in order to be there, but a lot of the other churches couldn't believe that a Catholic could represent the United Churches in any country, because a lot of the churches don't have the Catholic Church connected with their ecumenical instruments. And so it really says something about where we are in Scotland, that the churches in Scotland, if we talk about Acts, we'll see what that's about, that they actually sent a Catholic priest to be a representative at the World Council of the Churches Assembly. So there have, over the years, there have been assemblies in different places in order to focus the attention of the different churches on unity and to give a particular idea. Now, the prayer we read at the beginning was the prayer of the Pusan General Assembly, World Council of Churches Assembly, because its particular theme was towards justice and peace, the pilgrimage of justice and peace, that there was a commitment of all the churches to justice and to peace, and that will help us to become more united. As well as the assemblies that the World Council of Churches does, they do produce teaching documents, and the most significant over the last number of years have been this one here, Baptism, Eucharist and Ministry, hugely influential as a document, and it came out in 1982, so it's not new, but it still continues to have an impact because it was an agreement that the churches could come to. The Church Towards a Common Vision is the most recent document, and again, it's in the same style as Baptism, Eucharist Ministry, a convergence document. What can we all come together on? What one church believes this, one church that, how can we converge in what we believe? What are the essentials? And so it's very much a reflective and prayerful document to try to move us forward. And then the third one is, again, a very recent one from the World Council of Churches, Together Towards Life, and it's a mission. So again, focusing on mission as the way in which we can do ecumenism, and if we get our mission sorted out, we're going to move forward quickly. Big thing is that we're now recognising the global church. We're moving away from a Western church, a European church, to the influence of the Southern Church, and particularly those who are coming from emerging countries. At that World Council of Churches in Pusan, that was recognised, and the influence of these other churches and the conflict that that brings with it is quite significant. But we're a global church, and World Council of Churches has had to recognise that as well. The same way the Catholic Church has had to recognise it, and Pope Francis coming from South America is illustrative of that particularly. So the World Council of Churches produces documents to help us to have a theological understanding, and that's the faith and order part of the World Council of Churches. So you get peace, you get justice, and you've got faith and order, which are important. Now, the Roman Catholic Church has given us a foundation for our commitment to the ecumenical journey. Again, that's fairly recent because we weren't involved in the World Council of Churches up until fairly recently, but with the Second Vatican Council in the 1960s, there was that dramatic change, and the document on ecumenism was Unitatis Redemptorum Gratio, making that commitment to ecumenism and changing the whole mindset of the Catholic community, not to be exclusive, not to have ecumenism as wanting everyone to become Catholics again, but rather to recognise the goodness and the spirit involved in other churches. The Pontifical Council for the Promotion of Christian Unity emerged from the Second Vatican Council as the instrument within the Catholic Church to continue to promote Christian unity. And in recent years, it was led by Calvin Caspar, who was very instrumental in trying to move the Catholic Church forward theologically in a way to understand and to accept our churches too. And John Paul II, in his, I would say, most significant writing during his papacy, was a document on ecumenism, Ut Unum Sint. That was his teaching for the Catholic community and beyond to have this commitment to the ecumenical journey. And in it, one of the things he does say is, it's up to, he wants other churches to reflect on the role of the Bishop of Rome, and is there any way in which they can suggest it be changed and perfected in order to be more accepting to other people. So opening up questions rather than closing them down. And one of the ways in which the Roman Catholic Church and the World Council Churches cooperate is the Week of Prayer for Christian Unity. And again, that can be what happens in January, and it's throughout the whole of the world, and people come together to pray together and to reflect on the scriptures and to work together. One of the great ecumenical experiences I had was when I was in the seminary in Glasgow. The churches in Scotland were asked to write the materials for the week of prayer for Christian unity for a couple of years ago, and people came from all over the world, and they came and met in Glasgow, and we worked on that, and we had done all the work beforehand, and they kind of tore it apart and put it back together. And then it was interesting, at the actual week of prayer for Christian unity itself, Pope Benedict came out onto the balcony in St. Peter's on Sunday morning and started talking about it, and actually using the stuff that we had written in Glasgow, which is great. So that was part of the whole kind of involvement with it. It seems all this ecumenism stuff is away over there. It's not. It's actually the international stuff is very local as well. One of the most significant international commitments has been this joint declaration on the doctrine of justification. When you did some thinking on Luther, you know, saying that justification was one of the big themes which was instrumental in bringing out this misunderstanding. Well, in 1999, there was a joint declaration on the doctrine of justification between the Lutheran Federation churches and the Roman Catholic Church, which agreed that actually, we don't disagree on justification, we actually say the same thing. Just we quote here from Carol Casper, when he talks about that, it kind of explains it quite well. He says, Luther concluded that we cannot merit God's mercy by our own abilities, and that we are not righteous before God on account of our good works. Rather, we are righteous because God declares us righteous by his sovereign mercy and accepts us as sinners. The Council of Trent also condemned the doctrine that a person can save themselves by good works. The question at issue, however, was not about justification by grace or good works. Rather, it was about whether and to what extent God's action enables and stimulates the cooperation of the human person. So the Council of Trent concluded that we can cooperate in our justification, not by our own strength, but animated by the power of grace. So you look at two things from two angles, but it's the same thing. And so with this doctrine and the reflection, they're saying, yeah, of course we've got to rely on God's grace. Justification is not by our own merits. And Trent didn't say that. And so they agreed that actually we believe the same thing. That's a huge step forward that we've done that. And the World Methodist Council joined in with that to be a signature of that particular document in 2006, saying, we agree with that as well. So there's a whole movement on this, which was seemingly a cause of division, justification, and actually was bringing this together. Now, it's a vague theological concept, and there's a lot more practical things that we could be doing, but it just shows that there is this coming together in theology and reflection, and some of the things which did cause division at the time. So the joint declaration of justification is one of the great things that's been happening internationally. And there's been lots going on theologically in an ecumenical journey with ARCIC, which is the Anglican Roman Catholic International Commission. And these are the subjects we've looked at. And these are the areas that have caused division and that can cause us to become more united in our endeavours. Eucharist, ministry, authority, salvation, church and communion, Mary, these are all documents which they've reflected on and have tried to say, where do we agree? What can we accept in the teaching of each other's churches, and how can that help us to be more committed and move forward together? And so all those issues are issues that perhaps we can touch on when you start, when you reflect on your own about this, or when you do something which is the follow-up. Because ARCIC are doing that, and Methodist Dialogue are doing that as well. And they have come off with statements, an against statement on the Holy Spirit, towards a statement on the Church. We can actually agree on the Church, like the Church towards a common vision invites us to do, the apostolic tradition, the word of life, scripture, speaking the truth in love, recognising the hope and moral question, and the grace given to each of us in Christ. So these are the issues, these are the theological issues that make up the jigsaw that we are at our churches. And so by coming together with each of these ways, reflecting on each of these individual subjects, we become clearer of what we believe, what the other person believes, and actually we're not that far apart in what we're doing, and we can then have that foundation of commitment. The Reformed churches are very involved with international dialogue as well. We have the Roman Catholic Reformed Dialogue, which has done some work on the Kingdom of God. There's the Alliance of Reformed Churches, which work together. There's the Council of European Churches of Reformed Churches in Europe, which come together. It's a whole body of different ways in which the churches are already coming together in an international manner. And of course, we've got, as Joe mentioned, next year, the 500th anniversary of Luther's proclamation. And Catholics and Lutherans have issued common liturgical guidelines for ecumenical services to mark the occasion. So instead of saying Luther is roasting in hell for what he did, we're saying, actually, we come together to commemorate that occasion, and liturgically, we can celebrate it. That's a huge step forward. No. Instead of burning people at the stake, we're saying, let's get together, acknowledge the good things, and see where we're going. So next year is an opportunity for Lutheran. Difficulty is that here in Scotland, we are not a Lutheran country. Luther has not had a huge influence in Presbyterianism. There's a huge difference between Calvin and Luther, and the whole Scottish Reformation was not the Lutheran Reformation of Europe. And so there's a kind of reticence to commemorate Luther when we have actually commemorated Calvin a number of years ago. And so not that any of the Church of Scotland people are being protective about Calvin, but it's just, it's out there. It's out there. And we don't want the whole thing hijacked by the Europeans in that sense. I can't say that thing, but they're the Germans. Interesting. Pope Francis himself will actually travel to Sweden in October next year for a joint ecumenical commemoration together with leaders of the Lutheran World Federation and representatives of other Christian churches. So, and you get flack for that. There are certain elements within the Catholic community who think you shouldn't be doing that. But he's strong enough to make his own decisions and abide by them. And this coming together with Pope Francis and a commemoration of the what Luther has done to the church and what he's offered and how he's moved us forward will take place in Lund, where the Lutheran World Federation is founded. So it's interesting, we've got that. It's important that we have hinges to have our ecumenical celebrations with. Interesting, it's the Catholic Church find it difficult to celebrate Luther's anniversary. We'll commemorate it. That's the language we use. You fall into the celebration, it's commemoration. Now, let's go to the local situation, because that's really what we want to talk about. And the local situation from the churches together in Scotland has its ecumenical instrument, which is called Action of Churches Together in Scotland, and they are part of Churches Together in Britain and Ireland. So there's a whole movement of the institution of churches which is there to support what's happening at a parish and a village and a town level. But Action of Churches Together in Scotland is incredibly significant. It was founded in 1990. Prior to that, there was a grouping for the churches in Scotland, but the Catholic Church was not part of that. They were observing. But after, from 1990, probably as a direct result of the visit of Pope John Paul II in 1982, when at Bell Houston in his preaching, he said he wanted us to move forward, churches hand in hand, together, pilgrims, not strangers. And that whole process was given impetus that we are pilgrims, not strangers. And out of that, emerged actually churches together in Scotland. So it's a joint initiative of the Church of Scotland, Congregational Federation, Methodist Church, Religious Society of Friends, the Roman Catholic Church, Salvation Army, Scottish Episcopal Church, United Free Church of Scotland, and the United Reformed Church. So they all get together and reflect on issues and commit themselves to each other and work together. And at the present time, there are three initiatives, or three focus that ACTS is putting its efforts into. First one is local initiatives, local ecumenical support. The second one is faith and order, to recognise that it's important we know our theology, it's important we know where we're coming from and we dialogue together. And the third one is peace and justice. So those are the areas that the churches in Scotland are committed to working together with. And ACTS tries to bring together people in positions of leadership within the church, particularly to make that commitment and to give that leadership so as that what's happening at local level will be supported. Because most of what happens is happening locally rather than at the institutional level. But ACTS is an instrument to make sure that institutions are coming along with that as well. So it aims to bring Christians of different traditions in Scotland closer to one another in our shared faith in Christ by meeting, by praying, by learning, by reflecting and acting together in matters of common concern. So it's useful that we do have that body which oversees all the churches and all the churches are responsible for and are committed to. And so part of Acts is if we can do something together, we are committed to doing it together. We don't always do it, but that's what we say in our commitment. And one of the things that has come out of Acts is this document, which was, I mentioned, the Pusan World Council of Churches. There were representatives of the Church of Scotland there, they were representing the Scottish Episcopal Church, because they are members of the World Council of Churches, but under the umbrella of Acts, I was there in order to represent all those churches at that time. And when we came back, we reflected on the documents which were produced in South Korea, and we produced our own study document. And hopefully it was enough for one each for you. I've brought a fair number, I don't have mentioned, but anyway, at the end of the day, you can pick up one of those documents, and it just gives you an idea of how we're working together in Acts and in the churches together in Scotland about unity and how we're trying to promote and encourage local groups to take up what's happening at the international level and put it together. So this unity statement is, it's divided in very simple language, divided into four areas: God's gift and call to unity. So unity is a gift that God wishes us to enter into. We recognise that scripture is important and we have a shared scripture which is helping us. What does that mean for unity today and how can we then be committed to that? So that's your homework. Okay. Other good things that are happening locally, the Episcopal Methodist United Free Church connections which are there, United Reform rather. This is a grouping of those three churches in Scotland who are committed to one another and can share ministry and share involvement in churches. So there's a good connection which is on there between those three churches, Scottish Episcopal, Methodist, United Reform. The wider churches within the Reformed tradition, including the Church of Scotland, were part of an even greater initiative, which was the Scottish Churches Initiative for Unity. That was Skifu, but it hit the buffers. And it's worth reflecting, why did it hit the buffers? And is there any way in which that can be resurrected at some point? I think it was something which caused a wee bit of difficulty within some of the churches. But it showed its possibility to get together, but it's not always easy. And sometimes you have to take a step back in order to take a step forward. But there are initiatives which are there. One of the big initiatives that I'm particularly involved with is the Joint Commission of Doctrine of the Church of Scotland and the Roman Catholic Church of Scotland. And Alan Faulkner has been very influential in that over the years. And if he'd been here, we'd been talking quite a wee bit about this. And again, it's representatives from the Church of Scotland and the Roman Catholic Church of Scotland where we get together in theological dialogue and we move forward. And it has contributed to the ecumenical movement in Scotland in fairly significant ways over the last number of years. We came together, we produced a baptism booklet, which was our shared understanding of baptism, how we can be united in our baptism. We then produced a rite of baptism that we could share together, and that was recognised. We actually celebrated that at St Giles in Edinburgh after one of our conferences with the moderator and the Episcopal Bishop and the Cardinal and all those kind of things. So there was a real sense that it was recognised as part of the local church's initiative. The Joint Commission, as well as its reflecting together, does encourage wider reflection from other churches. And over the last number of years, we have been involved in conferences. We had a conference on Calvin, an anniversary, and brought people in to reflect on that. We had a conference on the anniversary of the Second Vatican Council, which coincided with the Year of Faith in the Catholic Church. Our most recent one was on the Church Towards a Common Vision, the World Council of Churches document, bringing people in, theologians, experts from England and Ireland and Europe, to try to stimulate some sort of intellectual activity as well within the churches. So that's important from the Joint Commission Doctrine. And at present, we're involved in preparing for one with the title of Semper Reformanda, recognising that the Reformation is important, but we're all called to be reformers and reforming. And Pope Francis himself has said that the Catholic Church should be involved in this Semper Reformanda. So what does that mean to us today? How can we move that forward? So it's quite an exciting time. You see, I go to these ecumenical meetings thinking these are going to be terrible, and somehow know, excitement bursts out, you know, and it's unusual, but it happens that they're exciting. And joint Christian doctrine is a particular way in which we can work together and a level of excitement there. And for those of you within the Church of Scotland, a very exciting initiative just there in last month was the signing and the recognition of the Columba Declaration, which you'll have heard about. And what it was, the General Assembly unanimously backed this landmark agreement, entering into an historic ecumenical partnership with the Church of England. And the Columba Declaration does say that the Church of Scotland and the Church of England are committed to working together and will make steps to do things which are there. So under the terms of the agreement, both denominations would welcome one another's members into congregations, and ordained ministers would be allowed to exercise ministry within the existing discipline of each church, but only within England and continental Europe. So there are difficulties within there. There's also difficulties with the Scottish Episcopal Church as the Anglican, as the Church of the Anglican Communion within Scotland, and why it was an agreement with the Church of Scotland rather than the Scottish Episcopal Church. That's not for me to discuss. But it does also connect that the Church of England has got lots of different bilateral agreements with other churches, which are national churches. And that has something to do with it, I think. Okay, so that's where we've come from. That's what's happening. That's the whole church. Where do we go from here? What does it mean? As Joe says, the future is important. So, first thing we have is unity already exists. We're not coming out of a vacuum. We have developed tremendously over the last 500 years. Developed tremendously over the last 25 and over the last 5 and 10. And so unity exists in lots of different ways. What's happening tonight is just a concrete example of the unity which happens. So we have to recognise that first of all. Unity does exist. There are lots of ongoing dialogues at an international level between two churches with lots of churches involved. And so that's happening. Dialogue. And if we can dialogue with each other, breaks down barriers, it lets us see more clearly. And the goal that we have, and the goal of the churches, the goal of the ecumenical movement, continues to be visible unity. Now that's interesting because it's worth unpacking what is visible unity, and are we still committed to visible unity? It's one of the questions within the ecumenical dialogue just now. Are we prepared to have less than visible unity in order to be together, or are we still working for visible unity? And it's one of the interesting things. Good, I've got an interesting quote on that whole concept about visible unity, again from Cardinal Casper, which is interesting. Can there be change? It's in theory we're still committed to visible unity, but there'll be change. He says, the ecumenical goal accepted today by most of the ecclesial communities stemming from the Reformation is not institutional unity or organic unity, but conciliar fellowship, or a communion of churches which remain independent but recognise each other as churches and agree to altar and pulpit fellowship as well as mutually accepted ministries and services. So that's a step towards full unity, but is it enough? That's just a question. And so the goal of visible unity remains, because that's what we're committed to in all our churches. The World Council of Churches documents state that, the Catholic Church's teaching states that, the Reformed Church states that, but we're not quite there. So there are issues then, there are neurologic issues which touch on all this subject, and that's what we're looking at now, because this is future ecumenism. We have to look at these issues in order to recognise where we're coming from and where we're going. And the first issue, which continues to be of great significance today and tomorrow, is the question of intercommunion. Lots of people, when we have shared services, or when we talk it within our churches, or when we go to each other's services, it's that question of, do I go to communion, do I not go to communion, why do I go to communion, why do I not, why does the Catholic Church not allow me to go to communion, those kind of questions. Well, it's because, how do we look at sharing communion? Is it a means to unity, or is it the goal of unity? And that's against the two sides of this one thing. From the Catholic Church's teaching, we share communion when we are in communion, and so we are in the process. Once we have reached communion, we can celebrate communion. Other churches and the World Council of Churches would say that actually by sharing communion, we are being helped on a journey towards communion. So it's two sides of the same coin, And so, does sharing communion reach communion, or do we become united and then share communion? So, it's worth thinking about. It's also important to recognise what does communion mean within each of our churches, and what about those churches which are non-sacramental? Well, in Acts, can't talk about communion all the time. Salvation Army is a full member. You don't celebrate that. And so it's not all about sacramental or non-sacramental. The bigger issues are there. So, yeah, communion is important, but we're about to see it within the context of all those other issues which are part of the ecumenical journey as well, particularly with a movement towards other churches. And we look at in privileges dialogue, that's another question. But communion is worth reflecting on. It's one of these questions which you have to kind of contend with. Another neurologic issue is that of the episcopacy, or the question of bishops. And it is something when the Scottish Episcopal Church and the Church of Scotland were in dialogue, it is one of the main causes of difficulty. That do we need bishops in the church? Are bishops part of the will of God for the church? Is the order of deacon, priest and bishop sacramental within some churches? Is that integral to what we understand as church? What about the whole role of overseeing? Are bishops in other churches in another name? Within the Methodist church, superintendents basically perform the same work as a bishop would do in one of the more Catholic churches. And so, is it language? What about the bishop? How do the bishops work together? What's this synod of bishops, collegiality of bishops? How can decision making not simply be made by an individual, but a bishop in collaboration? All those questions. And it does relate back to when we profess our faith, the church, one holy, Catholic, apostolic. Does apostolic mean we can connect to the 12 apostles? We have unbroken succession to those body of men? Or is apostolicity seen in the way in which the apostles transmitted the faith, lived out the faith, passed on the faith? And so is the wider concept of apostolicity found not just in apostolic succession, but in the concept of lived faith and leadership and oversight and all those things there. So it's a great one. So look for some things to talk about for your study stroke. Episcopacy, apostolic succession, one holy Catholic apostolic, what does it all mean? And another neurologic issue is the Bishop of Rome. From the Catholic Church's point of view, can you have a church without a Pope? Can you have a church without a universal dimension, a universal leader, someone who is the sign and the symbol of the unity of the whole church? Or is it possible for other churches to have some sort of communion with universal oversight as a servant, as a symbol? Is it possible that we can have a Bishop of Rome, but not necessarily in the way in which we have the Bishop of Rome just now, the way in which his authority is exercised? Can that be changed? So all those questions are part of the ecumenical journey, and it's important that we can address them. And we recognise it's there. As I mentioned, Pope John Paul II said, if we're to be committed to one another, if we're to move forward, then I put it to you. Tell me whatever you think I should be doing. Tell me what the Bishop of Rome's role should be. How can we adapt and change this in order to make it more of a servant and a symbol of unity? Now, Pope Francis is doing a good job at it, and lots of other churches can see what he's offering and are responding to his leadership. Again, it's not the person, somehow it's about the role which is there. So, but it's interesting, the Bishop of Rome, that's all kind of tied in with tradition and traditions, because what's important, what's of God, what's integral, what is necessary for the church, and what are the human additions, right? What's devotional and what isn't? So that's tradition with a big T, and traditions that can change. We can't cast out tradition, but we can cast out traditions. But the question is, can we agree on what's tradition or what isn't? Scripture. Is Scripture tradition, or does Scripture stand aside? Again, we're back to the Reformation, the sola scriptura. Can we only judge our revelation by Scripture? Or is it Scripture and tradition? Or is Scripture a fruit of tradition? And all that reflection is worth kind of thinking about. What's God's will? Scripture and tradition is an incredibly interesting way in which we can reflect together. And one of the modern developments is this receptive ecumenism. And it's being promoted in a very powerful way by the University of Durham. And they're bringing together lots of people and they're promoting it all over the world. But this sense of ecumenism today, it's important that we recognise and receive the gifts of others rather than try to give them our own gifts. That should be our starting point. So in our ecumenical journey, rather than saying, oh, I'm a Catholic, and you know what the Catholic, this is the Catholic Church, and you should be doing this, and you should be doing that, rather than, okay, I'm a Catholic, tell me the gifts that you bring to the ecumenical journey. Tell me what you have as your church, the gifts, and allow me to receive those gifts. It's a different way of looking at it, but it's incredibly positive and hopeful for our journey, and it's attracting huge attention. Carlo Casper came to Durham to be part of that as well, and, you know, has promoted that as a way forward just now for our journey to help us to take a step forward. So receptive ecumenism is worth, again, reflecting on of where we are in the church today. And spiritual ecumenism is another aspect of that. Again, Carlo Casper was very important with that. A wee book, Handbook for Spiritual Ecumenism, which shows that ecumenism is not all turgid and long and big hefty tomes and, you know, having to wade through lots of footnotes, although a lot of that is. You can also have short, wee things, summaries, which are tremendous, and Carlo Casper, Handbook for Spiritual Ecumenism, just reminds us that it's all about prayer, it's all about our unity, has got to be about the Spirit, it's a spiritual journey. So, we do offer an openness to unity when we pray together. So public and private prayer are significant. This prayer, this spiritual ecumenism will change our hearts, and the holiness of life that we'll then have if we're committed to our spiritual journey will result in authentic conversion. And it's conversion that will bring about unity, because unity will be God's gift, but only if we are converted in order to be at one with each other. And this ecumenism, spiritual ecumenism, sees ecumenism as a spiritual process which requires more than ecclesial diplomacy, more than just the high teachings getting together. It requires more than academic dialogue, though academic dialogue is important. It requires more than social involvement, just having cups of tea together, and pastoral cooperation such as this. These are all part of it, but it's more. It's the Spirit leading us and helping us to move forward. So there's something very positive and hopeful about the spiritual ecumenism and the receptive ecumenism where we are just now. And it moves really on to the last thing, is interreligious dialogue. Is that the new ecumenism? If you're in the Middle East and you're being persecuted for being a Christian, when someone comes to kill you, you don't ask what kind of Christian you are. You know, you're a Christian, you've been persecuted. And so we have got to come together as Christians to recognise what's going on there and work for dialogue with the other religions. And so it's very important that we see interreligious dialogue and dialogue with those who are non-religious as part of the way in which we can become greater in our unity. And so the questions which unite us with those who have different faiths or no faith, questions of justice, of peace, of integrity, of creation, those are areas that we have to enter into and we have to allow to move us forward in our ecumenical journey. Because with other religions and with those of atheists and, you know, anti-religion, it's from confrontation to encounter. Okay, that's part of our movement. And we're encouraged to encounter in order to help and to learn. So interreligious dialogue is part of our mission of the church. It's not opposed to mission. We're not giving up our mission by dialoguing and recognising where God is present in other religions and beyond the confines of religion, but where it's part of our commitment to mission and to the God that we believe in. But interreligious dialogue is a very important part of where we are in our churches today, and a lot of the churches have given a lot of time to it. So, where does it lead us? Where we've come from, what we're doing, what's it mean? Well, we are united, and there is unity in our diversity, and that diversity is to be celebrated. The diversity is present, and perhaps is to be promoted and encouraged in our structures. We don't need one structure in order to be united, as we have to go beyond the structures. It's not only structural unity we're looking for, it's something far greater. In order to have that unity, that diversity, that tolerance and acceptance, We have to be committed and committed to dialogue and that ongoing dialogue of listening or accepting the gifts or being receptive to other people and other churches is very important. But it's hopeful because we are united in our diversity, we can celebrate our diversity, and there's a lot of ways in which that has changed dramatically in recent years and will continue to do so. So that's where we're at. That's where the churches are united already, and it looks as if we can continue to do that in order to do what God's will is, which is unity, nearly all being one.
Thanks, Willie. What we've been doing up to now is maybe for a 2 or 3 minutes just to talk to each other to see if there are any comments or questions that you would like to come up with. So maybe just 3 minutes to do that. And if you don't mind, at the very end, I'd like to say just a few words of where we go next, if anywhere. But I would like to go somewhere. just a few words to say about that at the end. But just 2 or 3 minutes just talking about
the wisdom of the group and reflections and comments and clarifications and corrections of my presentation. Complaints or comments and or nothing, just go home.
I would just say that in Ardrossan we have had a very strong ecumenical group for a long number of years. Our minister was a lady minister for 37 years and with the Catholic priest at the time. I'm talking about 60s, maybe earlier, they formed the Ardrossan Churches Group, and there's still a strong Churches Group in Ardrossan. We all work together.
It's at a local level that things happen. Yeah.
I seem to remember this happened naturally. When it was social work, as in Goals, because that was very ecumenical. Anybody that wanted to help the Goals went and lived there as a start for a kickoff. And then they found the Scottish Episcopal Church and the Church of Scotland, and I don't know who else, and people who weren't even ordained clergy. And that was really ecumenical.
Yeah. If there's a task to do, it often brings you to food banks.
Yes.
So the second thing is, it's ecumenism in practice.
Yeah. I think just in rural communities in Patland and Huntington, where I used to work, we as Presbyterians were invited to the Good Friday service by the Catholic priest, and it was amazing, and so many people went. And I think because we were a small number, we felt we needed each other maybe more than some of the other churches in here where I now worship.
Sure.
Where we're quite we're much more self-contained.
I wonder if one of the fundamental issues which you did touch on is the distinction between what is international and what is national. Because if you look at the leading Eastern Orthodox people aside, I think struggling to put a conference after 1,000 years or more, but leaving them aside, if you look at the other Christian churches, the Catholic Church is very much the international church. The Anglicans struggle to have an international church, but if you then go to the other end of the spectrum, you can suddenly the Free Church of Scotland, you don't talk to anybody else, now much. But now, I just wonder if unity and diversity is all one will ever have, because the national will always assert itself, and it's kind of remarkable that the Catholic Church has survived as an international organisation given the power of nationalism. I just wonder how, in the end, one resolves this tension between having an organisation which operates across the world and others which are much more limited in terms of their geographical locations.
I would hope it's something to do with the Holy Spirit as regards the Catholic Church. But yeah, the nationalism thing is very, very important, and it's really something to do with the way in which dialogue takes place, because churches which aren't very immersed in the particular nation have an identity that the other churches don't have, and that, with that identity comes security, And so it's like the EMU coming together, these smaller churches in Scotland can come together in a way that it's far more difficult for the Church of Scotland to unite with the other churches as well. So that there's something about there which is definitely connected with the international thing. It's also interesting with the referendum tomorrow and the whole concept of Europe as a body, and there's something to do with nationalism which has emerged from there. And another very interesting article, someone talking about this, basing it from the English Reformation and from Henry VIII, and from that time onward, the English Church did not look to Europe and did not look beyond the boundaries of England, and actually the mentality which would not want to look beyond itself might be something to do with that, which is an interesting concept, you know?
Yeah.
Yep.
But does this really happen in the mission field? Surely, well, it's probably been out of date now because most of the world knows about Christianity, but surely in the 19th century, if all different churches met in the middle of Africa, there wouldn't be a problem, really, would there? Because they're all trying to make Christians.
Again, and that's, yeah, there's something about the practicalities that when you're in a situation, you're forced into a situation, you respond differently. And that's what's happened with a lot of our ecumenical churches. Oh, yes, there's the importance of personality and relationship, which was there. And as relationships have developed, then so barriers have broken down. I think in the Catholic Church in Scotland, that's happened recently because people, through the whole kind of acceptance of relatives who are no longer Catholics, that years ago it was such a close community that everyone you knew was a Catholic. Whereas then you get aunties and uncles and cousins who are not Catholic, so it changes the whole outlook which is there. And that's probably the same from different churches, because you say, my goodness, didn't they ask a nice person? They're my relatives. Probably can't go to hell after all. So it changes the outlook. Yes?
But the way you've described the approach to it by concentrating on creating our shared beliefs and shared values, yes, rather than necessarily worrying about how they manifest themselves in an organisational sense. Mm-hmm. It's got to be the way forward, because organisations will die defending their right to be organisations, even if they don't really understand why they're there in the first place. Whereas if you can share the agreement among people in organisations about what really matters and what the important things are, then suddenly you realise that the organisation's actually on, because there are all these other people out there in different sorts of organisations who believe the same thing.
Ultimately, it's the God of the Church, rather than the Church of God.
Yes.
And in the theological language, that is the tradition, and the traditions. You know, so that we shouldn't be defending traditions, you know, with our lives, but tradition maybe is something worth fighting for. So, yeah. That confusing.
I like the phrase visible unity, because I can see the problem is that when you just aim for unity, you're going against diversity, and diversity and unity are both important, right? So the phrase visible unity, it allows you to aim to get common ground, to come together in a visible way, but to keep your own tradition and individuality. That seems to me to be important. I was very happy to hear you speak of bringing people of different faiths together, but including people of no faith. And one of my favourite characters is Mary Warnock, the distinguished moral philosopher and chair of numberless high-level government commissions. She became so great that she got invited onto the Desert Island Disc radio programme of Henry Warnock. And Stu Lawley asked her, Mrs. Warnock, would you say you are a religious person? And she said, yes, of course. I attend church every Sunday when I'm at home. I love the antiquity. I love the words and the even when you started again in 1948, everybody was in the church. And well, we were all different churches, we still had an important ambition to bring them together. But now, actually most folk, certainly a lot of folk, are not in churches at all. But we all believe in justice and peace, and I think I would have added love. And we all have a spiritual side, and so if we can be talking together, then that can only be good for everyone.
And certainly by recognising the other religions, they have a role to play, and people with no religion at all, it's a very important concept for our understanding of humanity and its relationship, which is there. So yeah, it's got to be. Got to be. Thank you. Yeah?
Could I perhaps follow up on some of the things you're talking about, for example, Acts, which I was involved with some years ago. I always found that the great issue of that was when working with people, and particularly from Acts and into some of the charitable organisations, it didn't much matter from which particular denomination or grouping they came from. There was a common purpose in what they were doing. And I suppose it's that whole issue of, as we do these days, recognise diversity. But the great difficulty is that if we see the churches coming together all the time and looking to a common purpose, that's fine. But if they spend their time looking at theological issues and detail, then that's going to put an awful lot of people off. Would it not be better for just to accept the local diversities of different churches? But the important thing is that common cause of which they believe in, that comes to the fore, rather than a lot of detail on baptism or mass of that kind.
Except when we look at those issues and we can come to agreement, then that helps us to move forward, like justification. So it no longer becomes an issue of division.
But do those not then force that division further? Because when failure to reach agreement on those issues comes around, then there's no opportunity to come together.
I see another way. I think if bring us together, it will help us to move forward.
Okay.
Yeah, two sides of the room coming.
Yes.
Yeah.
Can I raise an issue about the patterns of our worship across the denomination?
Mm-hmm.
Despite all the progress in other ways, it strikes me that the patterns are very distinct from one another, and we don't seem to exchange ways of doing our worship across the denomination very much. Are there ways in which we could make gifts to one another in our worship?
Well, I remember when I was a young cure in Stevenson in the mid-80s, the minister of the High Kirk used to come along and ask for candles at some of the ceremonies that we were going to use, and what liturgical colour was it supposed to be wearing at that time. So that kind of sense of there's a reception of liturgy, of movement, of colour, some way, and the way in which the scriptures have been received and celebrated and taken such a prominent place within our sacramental churches in recent years, I think that's one of the ways in which we have learned from one another. So,
I think I've mentioned this every time we've met, but even before you start to do things together, the thing that would make the biggest difference would be if we could get rid of our prejudices. Because if we got rid of our prejudices, we would find that there wasn't much more to do after that. You know, that unity would become obvious if we could break through all that stuff that's been bedeviled us,
sure,
especially in the west of Scotland for so long.
Mm-hmm.
That to me would be the thing that would make the biggest difference. And I keep hoping that this is helping.
And it would be devils our institutions. And it's part of that institutional sinfulness which is there.
Mm-hmm.
And what those institutional sinfulnesses are, is that worth debating. Okay. Yes?
Concerning patterns of worship, in my experience, I've been brought up as a Church of England member. And when I attended the Mass in Knock, in Ireland, I found the service was almost exactly the same. That seemed to me that the pattern of worship is between some churches is very much already almost identical. In fact, in some places, before you follow the same readings,
yes.
It's certainly Easter in England.
Mm-hmm.
in the Catholic Church and in the Church of Eden.
Convention, which is it?
The other question I might have just asked is about the World Council of Churches set up for, what is the position of the Pentecostal churches these days? Because it seems to me that in some parts of the world, the Pentecostal churches are growing faster than some of the traditional churches, all sorts of them. And I notice it, I have watched Songs of Praise on a Sunday afternoon. And in the last year or so, it's changed a lot in its way in which they do it. And I notice also that a lot of Pentecostal churches, with a lot of, I think, immigrant Africans and Indians and so on, are there on a Sunday afternoon in a different pattern of worship altogether.
Yeah, it's certainly noticed in the World Council of Churches because they're not particularly keen to join any structure. A lot of the Pentecostal churches. So they wouldn't even join churches together in the local area. They don't want the structural side of things because they're free in that sense. So it is having an effect not only in the World Council of Churches, but in South America within the Catholic community, so-called Catholic countries, that there is a spread of Pentecostalism. There's also dialogue with Pentecostals taking place. And there's dialogue to try and see how can we worship together and what we're trying to do. So there are steps being made in that way as well. And in Acts are recognising that in Scotland there is a growing need for support for churches, Pentecostal churches, for those immigrants who come here, and the migrants are here have grown church communities, and we as the Christian Church in Scotland have a responsibility for outreach and support and to help them. So that's part of the wider global picture as well.
Sorry, Billy. Could you just say a bit more about that? I'm not seeing the difficulty that you seem to see. If there are two different traditions and you want to come together somewhere, then what is the problem about worshipping in the way of the other tradition in their place sometimes? And let them come to our place and worship in our tradition. And learning to do it in two ways is not possible.
That does happen.
Yeah.
I think that is one of the ways in which we've certainly moved forward as churches. So I don't think I said I was against that.
No.
This might be slightly controversial, but on that point, I think one of the things we have to face up to in Scotland is that whenever we have joint worship, it tends to be Church of Scotland style worship. And the reason for that is that Catholics have no difficulty worshipping in a Church of Scotland situation because you're reading the scriptures and you're praying. Equally, I can go to the Episcopal Church and have done at Kilmarnock and receive communion at Episcopal services and so on. But I think the Church of Scotland has a long way to go before it's prepared to join the Catholic style of worship, because there are theological differences in that area that we don't have with their worship.
Mm-hmm.
Is that to do with the transubstantiation thing, or could they not just come and to a Catholic one and just not partake, but just attend? Just be there, just do it, rather than, saying, well, I don't believe in that, and just not let the audience come forward that do believe that, and let the other one just listen to scripture and pray together, and then it's a step forward.
It's part of the sect of ecumenism and spiritual ecumenism. Somehow we can do that. How do we do it? What does it say?
Well, it's just reluctance, it's the lack of bending. There's a humility required in coming together, whether it's Protestant, Orthodox, or Catholics, where they all think they're right, and some require full communion and all these different things. You just do it.
And maybe that's the one that I should have stressed, and I didn't, humility, in the ecumenical journey. But instead of a receptive ecumenism, we're saying what you have to offer is valuable and is a gift. And it takes humility to accept the giftedness of the other. Yeah, good point. Josie tries to say it. I thought we could have the last one.
I just, as I said at the beginning, I'd like to say something about where we go next, if anywhere. This is the seventh year in a row that St. Bride's has had an adult education course which has gone from January through to June. Previously, although people were welcome, and some came from the other churches, we never advertised it. I was always slightly wary of doing that for a number of reasons which I won't go into. Unless you want to. But I think this year has taken us a step forward, and I wouldn't like now to take a step back and just go back to having something for Catholics even in their own place. The question is, where do we go next? The commandment, the West Kirkby Development Group held a meeting last year in the Village Hall, which was well attended. I was one of the people asked to speak. And I suggested that one of the things we could do with in West Kirkby was a forum where people could talk about things. And I'm wondering if this course this year could develop in some way in that direction. And I would welcome your views on it. At a kind of religious level, of course I've always wanted to do, but I'm terrified of the work that would be involved as a 6-month course on God. Does she exist? religion of faith, atheism, secularism, to explore all that. That's one thought that was true of mine. We could perhaps have discussed moral issues, semi-political issues, I don't know. We could have debates, people speaking for and against particular ideas and so on. I'm not quite sure what exactly it would turn out to be. But I just wonder what your thoughts are. Do you have any thoughts now? Or if you would be prepared to think about it and give us some thoughts. Is there a way forward? Should we go forward? And if so, what shape would it take? Would it take place here? Or should we go to a more neutral place? Should we go to the village hall or to the community centre? Or what do you think?
If you moved out of this building, would it not incur a cost as a practicality?
Yeah. In here, it incurs cost as well. I'm talking about obviously the lights and all that kind of stuff, you know, but that, yeah, it may well do, but that may be a price worth paying.
If you're talking about issues of spirituality and morals, though, then this type of building, to me, has a ambience that encourages that sort of discussion, which the village hall certainly doesn't. But you can overegg the importance of physical environment for these things. I think that's what matters. So I don't mind going to the parish church, I don't mind going to lots of other places in Paris.
I was touching the softer chairs.
That's true. Yeah, you're going to be more than the parish church.
You can bring your own cushions with you. And I know I've just had, just for a second, is there anybody else that has any thoughts at all? I mean, is the general idea that I'm proposing a good one or not? Well, we can go back and run courses here just for the listeners and all kinds of obscure theological matters, but I don't know if that's the way forward, having had this experience this year.
You have a broader community than your parishioners.
Sorry?
You have a broader community than your parishioners. That's exactly already.
What I'm saying is we could go back to just having a parishioners, but that's what I don't want to do.
I think there's a lot that could be done, and and what would seem useful to me would be a forum that would allow folk to come together for a discussion.
Yes, that's right.
The members of the forum might be nominated to take a turn at leading on a particular issue. But in whatever way it's organised, I found that a self-help basis usually works and keeps the thing going. So if you've got enough folk and enough people there with an interest in a particular thing, or you could get a book and begin to make your way through it, or you could make a list of topics and people could pick a topic and I'll lead on that topic in whatever meeting.
Well, the problem is that would require a smaller group than this, I think.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Maybe we would have a smaller group than this. Anything else? Anyway, will you think about it? And if you have any thoughts, you could email them or phone them, or you could have a copy of the Army or something and talk about it. Okay?
Yes, thank
you. So, anyway, just to thank Wally for coming. He's come all the way from Kakubri. He's staying in Kilmarnock tonight, but thanks very much for coming, Wally. You brought the whole thing to a conclusion, really, because, as I said at the beginning, the history is important. I hope it's changed some people's perception of the past, because in the younger time, we all have our prejudices, and if we don't realise we have them, that's when we're really in trouble. You know, because prejudices can be dealt with if you know you've got them, but if you don't know you've got them, then it's more serious. And we all have them, because it's such a... We're growing up in a country that's been steeped in particular versions of the Reformation and Scottish history, and as with Europe and everywhere else, we have to break out of that and see things in a much wider perspective. And Wally, you've brought it to a conclusion. You've invited us to see where we go next and to get involved ecumenically, which we could do a lot more, although it happens in all kinds of ways. Anyway, thanks for doing all that.